Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fried Chicken and Fangs by Bella Falls, narrated by Johanna Parker. Chapter 1.
I hate you.
I glared at Blythe, sitting down next to me, smugness radiating off her. The bright sun's rays beat down on us, giving me a powerful hankering for some sweet tea. But even some of the delicious nectar of the South might not improve my mood.
Next time, maybe you should volunteer to be on the committee. Then you might not get stuck doing something you don't want to do. Here.
One of my closest friends and longtime confidants pushed a tall cup with a lid and straw into my hand. Maybe this will make it all better and stop your sulking. I had been one of the biggest supporters of making changes to Honeysuckle Hollow, and I counted the idea to add a Saturday market open to the magical community at large surrounding our small, isolated town as one of my better contributions behind the scenes. But I would figure out who volunteered my behind to sit at a table with a sign labeled Lost and Found. I would find them, and then I would hex their hiney into the next century.
Not likely, I pouted. Whose bright idea was it to put me in charge of this?
I tore off the sign and waved it in front of my friend's face. Blythe made little effort to stifle a chuckle.
Someone said that at other farmers and flea markets they visited, there's always a lost and found table. We wanted to be like all the others.
But who decided to make me be in charge of it?
I narrowed my eyes at her.
I didn't know how a table like mine worked at markets outside in the human world, but I had a nagging suspicion how it would turn out with me and my tracking powers in charge of things.
She shrugged her shoulders.
Not my place to tell. If you want to join the committee.
I am not going to join a group with that name, I interrupted.
Aw, come on. You know that's not the official name. That's what Henry calls us whenever he hangs out at Harvest Moon,
protested my friend.
He calls you Poop, Posse of Open Progress.
Nobody should volunteer to be a part of Poop.
I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Names are important.
Taking a sip of sweet tea, I slumped into the back of my chair, giving side eye to the few people lingering in front of my table and reading the sign that Blythe had put back in place.
The committee doesn't have a name. It's just a group of us the council put together to discuss and help implement new ideas and changes to our sleepy little southern community. With the upcoming election for the new council seat, you know things are going to get tense around here.
Blythe looked over at the gazebo, where others were setting up for the candidate speeches later that evening.
Yeah, I agreed. Whenever Nana's stressed, she cooks and bakes up a storm. She sent so much good food home with me to Tipper's house, I haven't had to fire up the stove once.
Not Tipper's house, your house. You need to get used to saying that.
It's been long enough, honey bun.
My friend rubbed my back. How's the clean out going, by the way?
It's gonna take me a long time to go through all of my great uncle's things. I don't want to throw anything out that has value.
I sighed at the thought of the daunting task.
Bo has actually been a big help.
When I'd offered the plump older vampire and former best friend to my great uncle the opportunity to continue to stay and live in the house as my roommate, I would have never guessed how much I would appreciate his presence.
And not just for his cheerful willingness to sort through all the stuff that Tipper had hoarded, although my occasional and usually empty threats to kick him out might have been an influencing factor.
Blythe pointed at something.
Uh-oh, incoming.
Skeeter Johnson bobbed and fluttered in our direction until he hovered up and down in front of us, his wings working overtime to hold up his plump cherub body.
The disgraced and unemployed Cupid's hangdog face drooped with even more disappointment than usual.
Excuse me, Miss Charlie, but I could use your help finding something.
He pointed at the sign.
What's missing? I asked. Did you lose something here at the market?
He shook his head, the trucker's hat he wore on top of his messy curls, shaking off center.
No, Miss Charlie. I mean, I could use your skills to help me find a specific item that I seem to have misplaced."
He cast his eyes to the ground in shame. My heart took pity on the poor fella, and I sighed. "Fine, what is it you lost?" His eyes brightened at my willingness to help.
"You see, I have an interview coming up. The supervisor of Cupid Local 303 is willing to reinstate me on a probationary basis."
"That's great. Congratulations." Unable to clap him on the back due to his wings, I held up my fist for him to bump. He stared at my hand, unwilling to accept my praise, his lower lip trembling.
"Except I lost my quiver."
He wrung his small hands together in worry, his eyes darting around to make sure nobody heard his shame. Having had experience with one of his disasters, I pushed the tiny troublemaker. "Just the quiver? Or what goes inside it as well?" Any Cupid worth his or her salt needed their official equipment. On top of that, having a Cupid's arrow out in the open for anyone to find meant trouble with a capital T. The little bugger blushed and averted his eyes in response. Pixie poop. I stood up, stopping Blythe from yelling at the helpless guy. "Okay, Skeeter, give me your hand and I'll see what I can do." I concentrated and gathered my energy and focus, waiting for the touch of his skin. For a few months, I'd been working on building my tracking skills, or bird dogging, as my late great Uncle Tipper used to call it. Before that, I'd left my hometown to learn from others with magical talents like mine. When I'd first returned, my practice time got waylaid by a teeny tiny little death curse that almost killed me. My skin had grown much tougher to the odd stares and occasional whispers. Still, after details of how I'd helped solve my great uncle's murder leaked, most everybody at least respected my peculiar magic. With the Cupid's hands clasped in mine, I gave him instructions to help me. "Picture the items you want. It might help to think about where they were the last time that you saw your things. You got that in your mind?" Skeeter scrunched his eyes closed.
"Thanks, so."
The trucker's hat came perilously close to falling off his nodding head. I closed my eyes, commencing the first steps of connection. "Concentrate on them," I demanded, following his lead and shutting out the rest of the world.
"Hold on,"
interrupted Skeeter. I blinked my eyes open. "What?" I asked in annoyance. He tilted his head.
"Aren't you gonna say a rhyme or something? I thought that you needed words to help."
"No, not always." I rolled my shoulders back and pulled the hovering Cupid closer.
"But if you need me to say them, then I will," I granted through gritted teeth.
Composing quickly in my mind, I cast my rhyme. "So Skeeter's chances don't wane or wither. Help me find where he placed his quiver. Let's not make the search too narrow. We also need the bow and arrow."
Making sure the Cupid was satisfied, I shut both eyes and concentrated. Images flashed in my head, and I felt the connection to the items draw me to them. His house, the Harvest Moon Cafe, the post office. Images of places where Skeeter might have visited appeared and vanished as I mentally followed the trail. One final piece popped up, and I had it. I let go of him.
"How much money did you lose?" I accused.
"Lose?"
His puffy cheeks reddened.
"Don't know what you're talking about."
Rolling my eyes, I got straight to the point.
"At Lucky's? Guessing you had some money riding on a game of darts with the leprechaun. Not exactly a smart plan, considering that the rainbow's end is his bar, and luck tends to be on his side."
I raised my left eyebrow at the Cupid. Skeeter hung his head.
"I took off my equipment so that I could have more arm movement to throw. And you're right, he took most of everything I had with me."
"Well, he's got your stuff too. But Lucky's good people, and he has it stashed behind his bar, waiting for you to come get it. So you better hurry,"
I advised. When he wobbled away in the air,
He left someone else waiting for me. A couple of teenage boys smirked and stepped up, elbowing each other and trying to push the other one into talking to me. "Can I help you?" I asked with suspicion. The taller of the two got pushed by his friend and stumbled into the table.
"Hey, I need to find something," he stammered.
His face reddened while his friend snickered behind his back. "And what's that?" asked Blythe, joining me at my side, challenging him. Clearing his throat for courage, the towering teenager pointed at me.
"Don't I get to hold her hand first before I say?"
"Depends." I crossed my arms over my chest, looking up at him. "Do you really have something you need to find?" Despite his friend's chuckles, the boy in front of me lost his nerve and shook his head.
"No, ma'am, not really."
He bolted away from the table, and his friend followed close behind, laughing with too much glee. Blythe glared in their direction. "I may have to tell their mom about their behavior." "Who's their mom?" I asked, miffed at being called ma'am. "Lena Mosley." My mouth dropped. "The who's are the two Mosley boys? The last time I remember talking to them, they were knee-high to a gnome." Blythe elbowed me. "Look out, here comes trouble." My brother Matt approached, with his wife following behind.
"We come in peace," he declared,
placing a plate full of food and another cup of sweet tea in front of me.
"I've never been so happy to see you," I said in relief.
"Whoever assigned me to this table should be fried in hot oil like chicken," my brother snickered.
"Someone definitely has a sick sense of humor."
I left my post and maneuvered around the table to hug my sister-in-law. Her growing belly pushed against me so that my hug became a little awkward. "Hey, Tracy Joe, what do you know? Although I should say Tracy Joe and Junior now." Despite my troubles at the founder's ceremony, my brother had found the time to celebrate the event and take advantage of the massive amounts of magic released that evening, resulting in our newest family member still cooking inside TJ's belly, which had finally popped out.
"I can't wait to meet the new Goodwin."
TJ blushed.
"We still have a while to go. In the meantime, tell your brother that he doesn't have to act as my bodyguard for the next few months."
Their large dog, Ross, leaned his massive body against my brother, proving he had what it took to take care of his mistress and the precious cargo she carried.
"See, even Ross the Hoss agrees with your wife."
The dog rightfully earned his nickname. If I were a few years younger and a lot of pounds lighter, I might have attempted to ride him like a horse. Instead, I accepted loads of his slobber while trying to pet him.
"Are you neglecting your warden duties, Deputy Goodwin?" I nagged.
"No, I do my job just fine."
My brother snatched a slice of cornbread from my plate and ate it out of spite.
"But tell my stubborn wife that she can hire people to help her take care of the animals. She doesn't have to do it all on her own."
"I keep telling you, pregnancy does not make me an invalid," countered my sister-in-law.
"Still, you shouldn't be moving heavy bags of feed or putting yourself in a dangerous position when you're checking on the larger animals."
My brother turned his attention to me.
"The Tanner's old mule almost kicked her when she checked on it the other day."
"And yet, I'm still standing."
TJ stole the last of the cornbread out of my brother's hand and gulped it down. I held up my hands.
"If you think I'm getting in the middle of this, then the two of you have unicorn manure between your ears. You're both right, and you both love each other. If you start from there, then I'll bet you can figure it out. If you don't, Nana is bound to find out, and then you'll both be sorry."
Reminding my brother about what happened when our grandmother got involved to solve arguments straightened him up real quick. He sighed and kissed his wife on the forehead, the nose, and then her lips.
"Let's leave my brat of a sister alone to work the table. Maybe she can spend the rest of her time here pondering whose idea it was to put her there."
He flinched away from my swinging hand and ushered TJ from my table with a protective arm hovering behind her.
"Coward!" I screamed after him. "Using your pregnant wife as a shield against a hex?
Shaking my head, I returned to my seat. Blythe patted my back and stood up. I'm going to go find Lily and Lavender and see if they sold out of all their flowers. I might buy Granny a bunch to brighten her day.
You mean you really do have a heart beating somewhere in that chest of yours?
I teased, grinning at my friend's sweet soul. She did her best to hide from the rest of the world.
Shh, don't go spreading that around. I have my reputation to preserve.
Hey, you're going to the candidate speeches tonight, right? She asked as she backed away.
I intend to. Save me a seat? I requested.
Shooting me two thumbs up, she waved and headed in the opposite direction. She stopped for a moment to speak to Horatio, who handed her a piece of paper. Maggie West, Sheriff Big Willie's wife, approached me and asked for my help in locating their half-Sasquatch baby's favorite blanket. I held up my forefinger and let the little hairy fingers of the baby curl around it. With little effort, the connection formed, and I told her to retrace her steps to the vegetable stand and check on the ground beside a large basket of zucchini. She thanked me and went to retrieve the dropped item.
"Excuse me," croaked a familiar elderly witch who had waited patiently.
She squinted at me.
"I seem to have misplaced my glasses somewhere."
"Okay, Miss Flossie, let me see if I can help." I held out my hand. When I focused my talents, a clear image formed in my mind. My eyes popped open, and I shivered in disgust.
"On a bedside table," I uttered. "Do I need to say where?"
Miss Flossie tittered.
"Oh, that's right. I'll have to get Beau to bring them to me."
She thanked me and shuffled off.
I would have to scrub my brain at the thought of her being with my roommate. And I might have to threaten the old vampire within an inch of his undead life about bringing his dates back to my house. No need to know about any hankying or pankying happening under my roof when nothing more than a brief friendly hug was going on in my life.
The Mosley boys returned and looked like they were about to try again when they caught sight of Horatio barreling in the direction of the table. The two teenagers scattered, and I greeted the troll with the warmest of hugs.
"I'm so happy to see you, Horatio."
"Greetings and salutations, my friend. Are you now offering your services for a fee? I think that would be a most capital idea."
He clapped me on the back, and all the air in my lungs whooshed out. It took me a second to regain my composure.
"No, no money, just helping."
"If ever you are in need of assistance, I humbly offer my services in helping you research the best way to go about setting up a business."
He bowed his head, his scraggly hair falling over his protruding brow. When he straightened, he handed me a piece of paper he'd been holding.
"Here."
At the top, it read, "Vote for Juniper, and let every voice, even the smallest one, be heard." Underneath the slogan that had been carefully handwritten in neat calligraphy letters, somebody had listed out reasons to elect the fairy. I read the entire list, impressed with each clear and concise point.
"Horatio, I would think that since you're one of the candidates, that you would be supporting, well, you, not Juniper."
"Alas, my beloved does not possess quite the flair for addressing others. I volunteered to assist her because I would like her to have every possible chance in the world," the troll gushed.
"Thanks, Horatio,"
a high-pitched voice squeaked. Juniper flew to his side and planted a kiss on his giant cheek.
"I'm a bit nervous, but Horatio is right. If I want my issues to be taken seriously, then I need to speak up."
I nodded in full agreement, ignoring the doubt that anyone would be able to hear her.
"I wish you both a whole lot of luck. I'll be rooting for you tonight at the speeches."
At that word, Juniper shivered, and blue-green fairy dust scattered to the ground.
"If I can calm my nerves and get past tonight, then I might just make it."
"Stop your worrying. You will do magnificently. Remember, there is no failure when you succeed at trying."
He lifted a large finger and tipped her bitty nose with it, with such gentleness that it melted my heart. Is that another quote from Shakespeare? I asked.
No,
the troll winked.
That is all pure Horatio.
The mismatched but perfect couple left me to go practice. The shy fairy had flourished under the attention of her troll, and with support like that, she'd found her bravery. If I had someone like that who could make me blossom, what might I be able to accomplish? When the Mosley boys returned one last time, I ripped the sign off the table. I didn't need anyone's support to know that today's volunteering of my talents had come to an abrupt end, since I'd found the resolve to tell those two troublemakers that they better get lost or risk getting hexed on their adolescent behinds. Bless their hearts. Chapter 2. The cool breeze cut through the lingering humidity of the day, creating a bearable atmosphere for tonight's event. Musical notes from the efforts of our school band danced in the air and grew louder and more in tune as my feet brought me closer to the park. Never one to be early, I found the area in front of the gazebo packed. All of the chairs were already filled, and unless my friends had reserved me a seat, I would be listening to the speeches from the standing area in the back. I scanned the crowd for my gang, and my heart warmed when I spotted my girls. None of them had arrived in time to grab a place to sit down, and they beckoned for me to join them, standing a few feet behind the last row. After hugging, we girls got down to the important issues at hand.
"Have you seen that hot-looking specimen who's new to town?" asked Lavender.
"He's visited the cafe a few times. I don't normally say things like this, but frosted fairy wings. He could make a tick on the back of a dog's neck burst into flames from his looks," Blythe admitted.
"Ew, that's so gross," Allison Kate said, scrunching her nose. "But I have to admit, he is pretty cute."
"Hey, what am I, a big steaming pile of unicorn dung?"
Lee looked less than happy at his new girlfriend's gushing. Allison Kate cuddled him close and peppered kisses on his cheek.
"It's just girl talk, honey bunny. You know you're my schnooky wookums."
She rubbed her head into his neck, repeating more syrupy sweet names. My stomach turned over. I think I'm going into sugar shock.
"Holy unicorn horn, you two need to rein in the public display of affection."
Lavender pouted.
"Aw, but they are so super cute. And we've been waiting so long for them to get together. Their auras look so bubbly and pink, I can't contain myself."
She vibrated in pure joy, earning a stern look from her cousin.
"We may have been wanting them to get together, Lav, but Charlie's right. Keep your sugary sweets at the bakery, alley cat."
Lily crossed her arms over her chest. Lavender clicked her tongue.
"Don't try to play as if you and Ben don't share a similar color surrounding you, lily pad."
Lavender wiggled her finger to indicate the airspace around Ben and her cousin.
"You two may not show it to others, but your relationship is as plain as day to me."
The two cousins squabbled with each other, while the rest of us looked on in amazement. Blythe bumped me with her shoulder and pointed.
"Remind me never to get that entangled with a man. They're nice to look at, but it will be a hot day in Honeysuckle before I turn into a fool."
"I thought you said there was a new guy to drool at in town," I accused.
"A girl can look all she wants, and he is seriously drool-worthy."
She puckered her lips and whistled.
The hairs on the back of my neck stood up, and a warm tingle rushed down my skin.
A strong presence joined me at my right side, and a warm hand brushed my arm.
"You ladies are gonna make me blush, talking like that about me,"
rumbled a deep voice that had become a familiar fixture in my life.
"Good evening, Mr. Channing. I thought you weren't coming to the speeches tonight. Changed your mind?" I teased.
Dash grunted.
"I just think that elections don't make any sense. It gives the illusion of freedom, but I guarantee that there's always something lurking behind the scenes. Someone influencing things to get the outcome they want."
"I guess that's not how pack politics works, is it?" I asked. The wolf shifter hardly ever talked about his past, and I ventured to swim into shark-infested waters, asking him anything about it. His eyes flashed amber for a second.
No, that's not how a pack works.
Without saying another word, he ended my line of inquiry. A brief, awkward silence followed, and I needed to extract myself to regain my composure and give my cheeks time to stop flaming.
I'm going to go find Flint to wish him good luck.
I wove my way through the crowd with quick feet. Walking around the edges, I made it to the back of the gazebo where the candidates gathered. Following a string of sneezes, I found Flint fumbling with some index cards that looked huge in the gnome's trembling hands. His wife, Gossamer, flitted above him, her fairy wings dusting him in pink. Flint sneezed again.
Trembling toadstools, Goss. You have to stop hovering over me. I've got this.
He squinted at his cards.
I know, Flinty dear. I'm just so nervous.
More pink dust floated down and covered her husband's beard until the gnome sneezed it off.
Anything I can do to help?
I called out, hoping to distract my fairy friend. Goss turned her attention to me and left her husband's side.
Oh, Charli, do you think things will go okay? My Flinty's been practicing for over a week now, and there's still so much to say.
She bit her lip, and her wings flapped in distress. Flint caught my eye and nodded in thanks for helping his wife. I reassured my friend.
Everything will work out as it should, Goss. You need to stop working yourself into a tizzy. And tonight's about introductions, not to stuff every little thing into one speech. You know your husband is well-liked in the community. I don't think it's possible for him to fail, no matter what the outcome is.
In my opinion, the gnome was the one to beat in the election. Horatio and Juniper waved at me, and I responded in kind. Gossamer turned and also wished them good luck from afar.
You supporting everybody, Charli?
She asked through her grin.
Oh, frosted fairy wings. The awkwardness.
Frankly, I'm for anyone to take the new position, as long as they have the town's best interests at heart. I dodged.
Perhaps I should run for office with my artful deflection skills.
You mean everybody but Rafe, right?
She clarified. The crowd standing around the lanky vampire was impressive. Unlike the others, Rafe looked every bit like a real candidate, with advisors at his side. The fact that two of them, Aunt Nora and Hollis Hawthorne, had existing seats on the town council didn't sit well with me. Nana had worked hard at trying to keep herself as neutral as possible since she sat in the high seat of power. But those two shamelessly whispered advice in the vampire's ear. No telling what might happen if Rafe earned the new council seat in the election. No, I definitely don't support all of the candidates. The music from the school's band stopped, and someone announced for everyone to take their seats. I'd better go join the gang. Waving at all my friends, I excused myself. A cold hand grabbed my arm and hindered my attempt to leave.
Charlotte, I'm surprised to see you back here. Are you intending to throw your hat in the ring?
My aunt's puckered face mirrored my internal annoyance. I forced my lips into a smile.
No, Aunt Nora, just showing my support to those who deserve it.
She released me with a wry grin.
All your good wishes will be wasted once they lose.
After Uncle Tipper's death, my aunt had stayed away from me, and I counted her absence as a blessing. My mother's sister still held no fondness for me, an emotion we both shared. I needed to evacuate before I found a proverbial knife sticking out of my back. Turning on my heel with speed, I ran into a solid mass in front of me.
My deepest apologies, miss.
The impeccable British accent caught me off guard.
Sorry, Rafe, I spit out without looking.
When my eyes met the curious gaze looking down on me, I startled.
Oh.
My brain scrambled to find other words, but failed in their quest.
And who is this fetching young creature?
The stranger asked.
A fellow campaign manager?
Rafe turned his attention to me and wrinkled his nose.
She is no one of note.
The snotty vampire sniffed, dismissing my presence.
She is an interloper who needs to find her place.
He pointed to the front of the gazebo, indicating for me to join the rest of the town. But I didn't miss his underlying meaning.
That's a shame,
the stranger said. He grinned, his fangs poking over his lips.
I would enjoy a tete-a-tete with you. In a professional capacity, of course.
I studied the attractive countenance in front of me far longer than I should. Something nagged at the back of my mind, and I attempted to grab onto a faded memory. Hollis Hawthorne cleared his throat.
Time for you to go, Miss Goodwin.
The struggling thought disappeared like smoke, and I shook it off and nodded, too distracted to come up with a witty response. Making my way to my friends, I stood at the back of the crowd, while my grandmother received whoops and hollers, along with loud applause, as she approached center stage.
Good evening, y'all, she cried out. Thank you for coming to tonight's event. This is a landmark occasion for Honeysuckle Hollow, and I know that it comes with great sacrifice on y'all's part to accept that we as a community are changing.
She launched into a small speech that I'd heard her rehearse at her house several times. Dash leaned over to whisper in my ear, his beard tickling my neck.
What's wrong with you?
Nothing, I said, unwilling to share my confusion and distraction.
Sure,
he whispered back.
I'll let you have your fib for now.
I shot him a sideways glance, quirking my eyebrow at him. How did he always know?
Shifter,
he mouthed, poking his chest with his forefinger. Whenever I questioned how he knew anything, he always answered the same. Whether or not the animal in him could sense my lie was irrelevant. He liked to remind me that he was more than a man. I never knew if he did it in teasing, flirting, or in warning. He elbowed me and pointed at the stage. My grandmother introduced Juniper, and the small fairy reluctantly hovered beside Horatio. Her wide eyes gave away her fear, and I wondered if she'd make it through tonight. Horatio stood up, his head bending down to whisper something in the fairy's ear. I smiled, glad to see their connection. Their match had become fodder for town gossip, not long after they'd met at Skeeter's singles event. But neither cared, having found someone else to cling to. After an awkward pause, Juniper drifted to the middle of the stage. Loud squeaks and squeals erupted from a small group of floating beings behind us. Juniper's employees from her business, Fairy Dust and Clean, screeched their support for their boss. The dour-faced fairy that floated next to them, Moss, barely cracked a smile, staying quiet and contemplative rather than joining her fellow workers in their excitement. The entire crowd held its breath as the small fairy attempted to speak. Someone shouted, "Speak up!" and the diminutive figure shivered, her blue-green dust scattering about her.
My name is Juniper. I own the Fairy Dust and Clean Services, and I'm running for the new town council's seat.
Her stuttering increased, and my discomfort for her grew. The fairy clasped her hands in front of her, and I feared she might explode in a ball of anxiety and blue-green dust. Blythe leaned in on my left side.
Why in the world is she putting herself through this?
I have no idea, I said. I think Horatio encouraged her. All I wanted to do was run up on stage and give the poor thing a hug. Nana stood up and approached the flailing being. My grandmother's presence filled me with relief. Putting a kind arm around the fairy's waist, she spoke low to Juniper. After she finished, my timid, winged friend nodded and cleared her throat. She stopped trembling and floated with more composure.
My name is Juniper, and I am running for the open council seat. I intend to represent everyone in town if I win.
A mild level of clapping followed her statement, and the fairy sighed and smiled, gaining a bit of confidence.
But I especially want to give voice to those who tend to be ignored or forgotten. Everyone must remember that we all choose to live here for different reasons, and we all have the right to an equal say.
She paused again, and her employees screamed as loud as they could, the pixies reaching a pitch that made Dash wince. Unfortunately, only a handful of us nearby could hear them. Juniper turned to glance at Horatio, who nodded in support. She cleared her throat and finished with a statement she must have rehearsed.
Also, though I may be small, everyone should know that I am strong.
She bent her tiny arm and pointed at her non-existent muscle. I giggled along with my friends at the fairy's joke. The rest of the crowd chuckled as well, and Juniper left center stage in relief, zipping back to her place with the other candidates, clearly glad her moment in the spotlight was over. The stage creaked and groaned as the gigantic troll went next. He towered over all of his opponents and the rest of the audience with his massive presence. Pushing the disheveled locks of hair out of his face, he bellowed, thundering loud enough to be heard probably 4 towns away at least.
My fellow residents of Honeysuckle, I bid you good evening and wish you hearty congratulations on this next step in the evolution of our community. As my dear friend Will used to say, the web of our life is a mingled yarn, good and ill together. We must heed his wise words and bond as one mighty collective to make our town strong.
Horatio launched into an eloquent speech peppered with language that several of the town's residents would have to look up. It amused me to no end that many of my friends shattered expectations. His intelligence and ability to reason would be an asset to the authority of the town. However, he had a long battle to fight for acceptance. No matter what pretty words flowed out of his mouth, not many people would ever trust a troll. Horatio continued,
I know that change comes at a cost, one that we are not always willing to pay. However, were I to be so fortunate as to win your hearts and be elected to the seat, I will do my best for every citizen, big or small.
He turned his head and smiled at Juniper, who promptly blushed a rosy color closer to Goss's signature hue.
And as we are rational beings, I will also push to broaden our library and its resources. For knowledge remains our best gift. May we use it to make the best choices for our continued future.
The troll placed a hand over his heart in sincerity. The light applause that followed indicated he had lost the crowd. No matter how intelligent he might be, his speech did not win over many people. Still, I beamed at him with pride, happy that he and Juniper had stood up for what they believed in on stage. They were both far braver than me, and I'd lived here almost my entire life. Dash stiffened at my side, his nostrils flared.
What's that awful stench?
What are you talking about? I murmured under my breath. A few moments later, a sickeningly sweet floral scent filled my nose, and I grimaced.
Told you,
Dash admonished. I pinched his arm. Don't let your head shift too big, or it'll fill up the entire park.
That smells like gardenias, right, Lily?
Lavender asked her cousin. Gardenias that are on their last legs, Lily agreed, covering her nose. Ben moaned.
I know of one person who wore that scent every day.
Lee took off his glasses and wiped his hand down his face.
I'm having nightmarish flashbacks to primary school.
A commotion at the front of the stage interrupted the evening's proceedings. After much grumbling and shouting, a familiar figure limped its way onto the stage.
I object,
a raspy voice rattled into the air.
We must stop all of this nonsense.
The figure waved a thick cane at the audience.
My grandmother, along with Aunt Nora and Hollis Hawthorne, rushed into action toward the crooked body, interrupting the speeches.
"Who is that?"
Dash asked, covering his nose with his hand to block out the smell that had settled over all of us.
"Old Mrs. K," replied most of my gang at the same time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.